If it's true that, as Shakespeare said, there are more things in heaven than we can imagine, then it might be justified to ask whether in the skies of the other planets of the solar system, celestial phenomena could occur quite different from those we are accustomed to observe on our planet. Different colors, speeds, masses, shapes, and volumes. Environments mostly hostile to life, and very dark skies where large and small moons move, with nights that last months or a few hours, or where the sun can suddenly reverse its apparent motion. In this journey, we will try to put together science and imagination, visiting the completely alien skies of Mars, Jupiter, and their moons. We are on Mars. The atmosphere of the red planet has a composition similar to that of Venus. It is composed mostly of carbon dioxide, a small percentage of nitrogen, argon, and traces of oxygen, and water. However, the density is minimal, and the pressure at the surface is less than 1/100th of the Earth's pressure. There is water vapor in the air, but too little, and the density is too low for it to rain. However, you can see mist and clouds in the sky of Mars. The main characteristic of its atmosphere, which significantly influences the landscape and the appearance of the sky, is the large amount of dust, mostly iron oxides, suspended in the air. A visitor to Mars could witness, especially when the planet is closer to the sun and the temperature is higher, the most impressive dust storms of the solar system. Sometimes only local phenomena, but in other cases so gigantic as to affect the entire planet, as happened in 2001. And it is just to the ferrous dust in the suspension that we owe the particular brown-yellowish color of the Martian skies. And to the same powders we owe the fact that the daylight spreads on Mars long before the rising of the sun, and that it still illuminates the sky long after the sun has set. The numerous probes that we have sent to Mars in recent decades have given us many suggestive images. We have been able to observe sunsets in which the sun is bathed in a blue light instead of red as on Earth, and violet skies due to the presence of ice crystals in the air. However, we must remember that these images are only an approximation of reality. All the probes that capture the sky and the surface of Mars, in fact, do so through filters that produce images in shades of gray that are then processed into something that resembles as much as possible what human eyes could see if they were on Mars. Since Mars is about 1.5 astronomical units away from the sun, the amount of light that arrives on the surface is less than half of the amount that arrives on our planet. And in low light conditions, our eyes shift their sensitivity to blue because we move from using conical color-sensitive cells to stick-like cells, which are practically colorblind. So the first astronaut who lands on Mars would probably describe the sky much bluer than you might expect. The light actually perceived on the ground always depends on local weather conditions, but there is no doubt that the general effect for a human visitor would be that of a world with little light, with equally little contrast. Certainly the disk of the sun would appear to us smaller than from the Earth. Its angular diameter seen from Mars is 19 arc minutes at aphelion and 23 at perihelion, respectively 60 and 70% of the diameter observed from Earth. Despite the great similarity between Mars and Earth in the initial observational conditions, the duration of the day and night virtually identical, as well as the respective inclinations of the polar axis, a hypothetical Martian astronomer would have fun observing shows forbidden to us Earthlings. He could see, for example, with a good telescope, the details of the hidden face of the moon. Or, even better, he could observe the transits of Mercury, Venus, and Earth on the solar disk. We have already seen for Mercury, also on the red planet, the Earth-Moon system would shine in the sky like a jewel formed by two points of light separated at most by about 23 arc minutes. And even an observer on Mars, therefore, would be able to see with the naked eye the moon orbiting around the Earth. Many Martian probes, orbiters, and even rovers have improvised astronomers, taking meteorites, constellations, transits, eclipses, and even more or less total eclipses of the sun. Even the moons of Mars, in fact, can project their shadow on the occasion of their passages in front of the sun. That of Phobos, in particular, a dark spot of about 50 kilometers, walks three times a day on the face of the planet, illuminated by the sun. There are many photographs, for example, those taken by the Mars Global Surveyor, that take this incredible phenomenon of the shadow that slides fast among the Martian deserts, as well as iconic, have become the photos taken by the rover Curiosity that depict the dark silhouette of Phobos practically eclipsed the disk of the sun. And hinting at the two satellites, we must admit that these two very small moons animate the sky of Mars. Phobos, the large, is sort of an asteroid of quite a regular shape, porous and pitted, with an average diameter of about 22 kilometers, and brightness that can reach 50 times that of Venus seen from Earth. Its appearance also varies very quickly due to the phenomenon of phases, the cycle of which is completed overnight. It orbits at a distance of only 6,000 kilometers from the Martian surface, which allows it to make a complete tour around the planet in 7.6 hours, a period much slower than the rotation of Mars. For this reason, Phobos rises in the west, on average twice in the same day, crosses the sky in just over 4 hours, and sets in the east. Also because of its peculiar proximity to the planet, Phobos is eclipsed by the shadow of Mars, immediately after rising until just before sunset, remaining a wandering dark shadow for much of its apparent path of the Martian sky. Its average angular diameter is about 10 arc minutes, half that of the Sun. Consequently, total eclipse cannot occur on the planet because the two moons are both too small to cover the solar disk in its entirety. On the other hand, from the equator it is possible to observe transits of Phobos almost every day. They are very fast and end in less than half a minute or so. Be sure to join the Insane Curiosity channel. Click on the bell, you will help us to make products of even higher quality. Deimos, observed from Mars, is instead so small, just 3 arc minutes, that it appears almost punctiform, even if it shrinks as much as Jupiter seen from Earth. When it passes in front of the Sun's disk, it produces more the effect of a transit than an eclipse. It orbits around Mars at 20,000 kilometers from the surface, with a period of 30 hours. Consequently, unlike Phobos, it rises in the east and sets in the west, but takes 2.7 days to complete the entire route. Certainly interesting would be to contemplate Mars from the surface of Phobos. The planet would appear to us 2,500 times brighter than the full moon seen from Earth, and 6,400 times larger, so much so that it would cover a quarter of the visible horizon. However, we must hurry to go to Phobos if we want to make time to enjoy such a spectacle. The satellite, in fact, is on an unstable path. The tidal forces slow it down and narrow the orbit radius of about 20 meters every century. In about 11 million years, it will be so close to the surface of Mars that it will be shattered, creating a beautiful ring of debris around the planet. But let's reluctantly leave the red planet and head towards Jupiter. Not having the giant of the solar system a solid surface, we must necessarily imagine a situation that allows us to observe its sky as if we were solidly anchored to the surface. Let's imagine then to navigate hanging from a balloon probe just beyond the highest gaseous layers and still follow the fast motion of rotation of the planet as if we were located above its equator. The sky looking outwards would obviously be completely black, maybe just bluish, and we would see below us a great spectacle of clouds of different colors, red, bluish, white, placed at different heights and subjected to a continuous movement due to the powerful horizontal winds that, depending on the latitude, blow from west to east or east to west, creating endless vortexes and storms. The colors of the different gases that the wind disrupts leaves the blackness of space upwards, and in the sky there are truly formidable lights. They are the so-called Medicean satellites, Io, Europa, Ganymede, and Callisto, similar or superior in size and angular dimensions to our moon. Apart from the Sun, the four Medicean satellites are by far the most striking objects in the sky of Jupiter. While the numerous small moons orbiting at various distances from the gas giant would be virtually invisible to the naked eye, all minus the small but very close Amalthea, 165 kilometers in diameter, which shines as bright as Venus seen from Earth and is visible as an irregular disk of 5 arc minutes. About the latter, there is also to say that being its period of revolution a little longer than Jupiter's period of rotation, its movement in the Jovian sky is very slow and retrograde, so that the small moon takes about 29 hours from sunrise to sunset. The Medicean satellites all move with direct motion, always turning the same face to Jupiter, and obviously show themselves with even greater brightness, and with average dimensions ranging from 36 arc minutes of Io to 9 arc minutes of Callisto. Due, however, to the smaller amount of light coming from the sun at these distances, the satellites would appear darker than how we see our moon. Even less, of course, would appear to us the brightness of the more distant satellites. On the whole, the Medicean or Galilean satellites would seem to move all from east to west, left behind by Jupiter's fast rotation. But Jupiter's diameter is so important compared to the distances of the satellites and the rotation period so fast that due to a very high diurnal parallax, the two outer moons, Ganymede and Callisto, during their apparent direct motion would show rapid reversals, respectively of 22 and 44 arc minutes of amplitude. For Io and Europa, with the apparent faster motion, there would be instead only a slowdown. A bit what, as we saw in the video, Alien Skies, the universe seen by Mercury, Venus, and Moon, happens for the motion of the Sun observed in the sky of Mercury. Io, the Medicean moon closer to the planet, we would see it slightly larger than the full moon in the Earth's sky, although less bright. And in fact, Io is the moon of apparent diameter larger than the solar system if seen from the surface of its primary planet. From Jupiter, the Sun would appear to us about 27 times less bright than if observed from Earth, and with an average angular diameter of 6 arc minutes, more or less a fifth of the size of the solar disk seen from our planet. Due to their relative proximity to Jupiter, and also to the fact that the orbits are completely coplanar with each other and slightly inclined on the ecliptic, the moons discovered by Galileo, but also Amalthea, would all appear large enough to completely cover the Sun with their disks. This would cause continuous eclipses of the Sun, as well as numerous periodic eclipses between the Moon and Moon. All this happens on Jupiter, but what would the sky look like when seen from the surfaces of the satellites? None of Jupiter's moons possesses a substantial atmosphere, so their skies would appear almost completely black. And for the hypothetical observer, by far the most prominent feature of the sky would be Jupiter. If we were in fact on the strange surface of Io, rich in highly colored volcanic deposits, we would see in the sky a Jupiter of about 20 degrees angular diameter, 40 times that of our moon, while an observer on Amalthea would see Jupiter looming with a diameter of 68 degrees. Can you even imagine what an extraordinary and frightening vision this would be? We are only halfway through our journey. In the next video, we will visit the complicated skies of Saturn and those of the very remote planets like Uranus, Neptune, and Pluto. Look for it on the Insane Curiosity channel.